Hello, and welcome to Castoriadis Autonomy in the 21st Century. I am Chris Speck, one of the usually three hosts of the program, together with Alexandros Schismenos and Nikos, we're the co-authors of the book of the same title. Nikos and Alexandros are on holidays right now, so we're doing a summer schedule, a bit slowed down programming, not weekly as we were. On this episode, we had a very exciting guest, Ingerid Straume. And Ingerid is a professor, philosopher of education and writer. And we're going to be discussing the idea of Bildung. And Ingrid will be joining us in just a moment. But I'd just like to open the program by framing the concept. We in our book, we talk about the Greek concept paideia, and we frame this in our discussion around ancient ontologies and conceptions of happiness, mortality, and immortality. And so we describe the objectives of being human more broadly. And one of the examples we look to is Pericles' funeral oration and his discussion of paideia, and that it was a way of living in and through the love of beauty and of wisdom of the city. And of course, that's a translation based on the Greek-French philosopher Cornelius Castoriadis' translation, and he goes into some detail around the way he translated that quote from Pericles and the meaning and why he quoted it the way he did, or why he translated it the way he did. And so the concept of Bildung that we'll be speaking with Ingrid about is connected to a very broad meaning of education, and it's very interesting and broad concept, and related to the process of self-reflection and both as individuals and as a collectivity, and self-reflection as a society as a whole. So without further ado, let's bring in Ingrid. Hi, Ingrid. Welcome to the program. It's great to have you on.
Hello, Chris. Thanks for having me here.
Yeah.
I'm happy.
So first off, am I pronouncing this word correctly, Bildung?
Yes, perfect.
Yeah, okay, great. I wasn't entirely sure. Maybe we can begin by, first of all, I mean, you're a philosopher of education and writer, and, you know, what's your relationship to this concept, and how did you arrive at even, you know, taking it on as a subject that you believed was important?
Okay, thanks for that question. It's actually a little bit complicated, because the problem here is that we don't really have a term in English. So that's why I've used Bildung or Paideia, or we do actually have a term in my language called Dunning. So in my language, we use our term, which is Dunning. But when I'm obliged to speak to an international audience, I have to choose either, you know, I can say Dunning, but nobody knows what that is, or I can use the German term Bildung, which is the more well-known, or Paideia, which is the Greek term. So these are similar terms for the same concept, so to speak, which is in English we would use education, but we would have to qualify it further, because it's a specific educational concept which has to do with culture and not only learning, teaching and learning.
So expand on that a bit more, like how, you know, if you had to try to describe the meaning of, and I understand it's complicated and there's various interpretations, and I hope we can get into that, but if you had to describe what it encompasses, how would you begin to approach those parameters?
So I would describe Bildung as the process of becoming a person or a subject in a culture. So in my analysis, every culture or every society has some notion of Bildung, but not every language has a term for it. Like English, you would say education, and then you would say maybe education in a broader sense.
But for example, it means more than just going to school and starting at, say, reception and going through, or kindergarten and going through high school and secondary and post-secondary. Well, it has I suppose it includes that, but is also much broader in the cultural sense that you're referring to.
Yes. So we often speak about formal and informal education. So Bildung includes informal education. And in the German tradition, actually the German Bildung tradition is very rich. So you have many various forms of Bildung concepts. You have political Bildung, you have self-Bildung, and this tradition of self-Bildung is quite strong. Normally when the term is used, it refers to something that a person does to him or herself to become more more of the kind of person that we want to be. So there's always an act of will involved, and work on the self.
I see. And but now going into these differences between self-Bildung and maybe a more social conception, you wrote a paper on Bildung and the Bildung from Paideia to the Modern Subject, and that was published in the Oxford Encyclopedia of Education. And And in that, you outline both conservative conceptions of Bildung, mm-hmm. and radical conceptions of Bildung. And what are the differences? How do those typically manifest?
Mm-hmm. So in many cultures, Bildung is not really a transformative ideal. It's quite often a rather fixed ideal that people try to achieve, so that would be the kind of conservative notion of Bildung. So we know what the ideals are and we try to achieve them. We have some kind of value hierarchy, and Bildung is like the on the top of that hierarchy. We have fine manners, we have, you know, you need to read the right books and have the right ways of behaving in finer layers of society. That would be a conservative and sort of stale ideal of Bildung. And then you have, in other settings, you have a more radical, more political notion of Bildung, like I said, political Bildung, which means to question society and be more of a reflexive kind of person, and these things are not only individual notions, because different societies have different ideals of Bildung, and some societies are more self-reflexive, and my take on this is that the more self-reflexive societies are also more interested in educational theories or in Bildung itself. And this is an idea that you can find in Castoriadis. He didn't spell it out in those terms directly, but I think you can find it there. So it connects very closely to autonomy, the ideal of autonomy, and questioning the self and questioning society's instituted values and norms. So this is also a notion of Bildung, and we can also find it in German and the Nordic languages, especially around 1968. This ideal of Bildung was spelled out by various thinkers.
I hope to get to that in a little bit, but before, mm-hmm. you talked about these different conceptions of Bildung and the more kind of social aspect and the self-reflective aspects versus the individual and the conservative aspects. And in your work, you discuss three instances, the Greek polis in the ancient democratic period, and 508 to 322 BCE, and then Germany in the period 1870 1830, and in the Scandinavian nation building period 1850 to 1900, and maybe you can how did this instance occur first in the Greek polis democracy of that period that you identified?
So my claim is that all those three periods had this sort of self-reflexive, the societies that in question, they were self-reflexive, and that's why they were so interested in Paideia or Bildung or Dunning. So that's when you get very rich theories about Bildung, because the societies were questioning themselves. There were deep changes taking place politically and socially, and they were very creative and productive periods, culturally speaking and politically. And so the idea is that's why they also turned to education. They had a keen interest in asking what is the purpose of education? Is the purpose that we have in our time, is that the best? Are these the goals that we want to achieve through education, and especially thinking about the next generation and not just transmitting the same values, the same ideals, the same social roles, but actually also questioning them and refining them, as it were.
You mentioned in the paper in the Oxford Encyclopedia of Education that the idea of Paideia related to Bildung was initially conceived as a part of or a component of form of child rearing. I find that very interesting because it immediately just broadens it out to a process of socialization, and that's very interesting. How did that interact with the rest of society and the conceptions of education, learning, in relationship to democracy in the period?
Are you thinking now of ancient democracy?
Yes, yes.
Mm. Well, Paideia meant not only child rearing, but it comes from pais, the word for child. But it actually encompassed the whole culture, as you mentioned. The funeral speech of Pericles was really about the Paideia of the city, how the people were the city. They were two sides of the same coin. So in that period, Paideia was held as a very strong value. And I think that tells us maybe that it's not only children who are brought up and then they are done and they can go into life as workers or consumers or whatever, but that this is a process that is ongoing. So even as adults, we have a responsibility to the political life and to ourselves, which is also a form of Paideia. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah. Yes. Yes. It's so different from what we experience, growing up. Most people in the West, anyways, in our modern societies. And then looking at one of the other examples you raise, Germany in the period of 1770 and in 1830. How did Bildung manifest itself in this period? How do you interpret that?
So in this period, it was a very creative period as well. Lots of developments in the arts and in literature and higher education. The Humboldtian university model was established. It was a really, really productive period, and like I said, Bildung was something that really interested and intrigued many of the key thinkers of the period. So most philosophers had thoughts and wrote about Bildung. And also interesting at that time, philosophy and education was two sides of the same coin. So if you had a chair in like Kant, for example, he was a professor not only in philosophy but also education. This is also where Bildung is not just something that takes place in school. Education is not something that's done once and for all, but it's really it reflects, I suppose, how a society or a time period thinks about itself, questions itself, and reflects upon itself. And so they had lots of discussions, you know, what should our education be? And should it be, for example, should we look to the Greeks? Should we should everybody learn Greek and Latin, as many thought? Or was it more the arts? Or was it the new sciences and technology? So these discussions all focused on the notion of Bildung, which is education. It's not more mysterious than that. But it's in a broad sense.
You mentioned Kant and this period, and I'm thinking about, you know, what you said earlier about the interpretations of Bildung as a kind of self-improvement or a self-education related to the individual. And I'm wondering, what's the relationship between that kind of Western Enlightenment period and the thinking around individualism of individual rights that emerged in that period with the conception of Bildung being about self-improvement? I mean, is there a connection there?
Mm-hmm. So maybe, if I understand you right, maybe there is an individualist bias or tendency in the German period. I think you're right. I think there was. And notions of political Bildung came later. So I think especially after the Second World War, there was a broad a movement in Germany to make a Bildung into a less bourgeois, less individualist concept, and more of a more radical, more political effort.
Interesting. I don't know. I'm not the expert, so I'm just taking advantage of expertise. Thanks for that. And so now, looking at the Scandinavian nation building period, 1850 to 1900. I mean, you talk about Bildung during this period, and again, what, you know, how do you interpret this, and you know, how did it manifest?
Yes, so the Scandinavian states, Norway, Sweden, and Denmark, all have a concept for Bildung. We call it Danning or Bildning or Dannelse. It's really the same. It builds on it. It comes from, well, there is obviously an older word, but it's quite influenced from German pedagogy, which in turn is influenced from the Greek, ancient Greece, Greek tradition. And when during the second half of the 19th century, these nations became democratic, and my case is mainly Norway. I know Norway the best, but they're quite similar. Norway had been first under Denmark and then under Sweden, and it became an independent nation and had to build itself with a parliament and universities and various institutions, and also a national self-image. And in that period, again, Danning, or to use the term we have used so far, Bildung was really important. And there was at that time, again, a discussion, what should Bildung mean? What kind of Bildung do we really want? And the more conservative, more bourgeois philosophers had a more classical sense of Bildung. And then you had the workers' movement. They also wanted Bildung, but it was a different kind of Bildung, more autonomous and of course less hierarchical. But the interesting thing is that they never disagreed about the value of Bildung. They just disagreed about the contents. So, so again, in a period of great social transformation, this concept comes into play. It becomes contested, but it becomes also very vivid.
And so, I guess the common thread that we're keep coming back to that's kind of underlying a lot of this is the self-reflective nature that Bildung can offer, the extent to which it can offer, it can help individuals can create themselves within a culture and a society that enables self-reflectiveness or to more or less of a degree. And so looking more at our modern era, you spoke earlier, you mentioned 1968 and that being a period where that kind of, I don't know if this is the direct correct characterization, but like a deeper self-reflectivity or conception of Bildung, which was in line with that. Say more about that.
Mm-hmm. So I agree that Bildung has the capacity for self-reflection, but I think it's mainly on it's more on a social level. So it's a society that reflects upon itself by asking the question about education. And this became very acute then in after the Second World War and during the student, what do you call them, student rights or student movement, where the values of bourgeois society were really questioned and contested. And the interesting thing is that at least in my country, some of the more radical philosophers, they used Bildung to do this questioning, and even went back to antiquity and used Socrates again to question the state of affairs at that time. So it can be used for a lot of purposes. And the interesting thing is I see that when I was a student, whenever there was some reform that was under critique, for example, if there were new public management reforms and the like, then Bildung would be would be revitalized, and we would use this as a pry bar, something to pry, you know, to really question and unsettle these reforms, because Bildung has that or Paideia has that capacity to bring in a different perspective.
And when you're thinking about, you know, contemporary examples of, mm-hmm. of these opportunities to kind of pry open a wider discussion and debate, mm-hmm. what comes to mind for, you know, today in terms of good examples?
For me now?
Yes.
Yes. So I've just been thinking about this because I just reread some passages from Aristotle in the Politics, where he said that the first duty of a lawgiver is to make sure that the young people in the society that they have education, and because it's the people who created the society in the first place, and they also maintain it. So, and he also says that the best character gives the best constitution. So what this means is that every society has a corresponding social type or type of person or subject, if you like. And if today we have a neoliberal society, then the social type that this being produced by socialization and schools must be a neoliberal subject. And we know this, you know, this is a very flexible subject that is willing to learn. Doesn't matter what they it's the willingness that's the point, and this flexibility. And likewise, if we have a competitive society, we have competitive people, as you know from many school systems. They foster competition. And even to go even further, you may say that we have a society of surveillance today. There's a lot of surveillance. And so we have a social type that actually accepts this surveillance. And this must be a person who is always on social media, you know, that goes hand in hand. And to critique these kind of socialization that is unquestioning, or I wouldn't say we're not self-reflexive, because I think we are self-reflexive, but maybe too self-reflexive. So there's maybe the difficult thing today is to hold on to something. Maybe, for example, to hold on to the idea that we are responsible for the social structures politically. So to make this critique, I can look to for example the Paideia of the Athenians and see how they were actually very aware that they were responsible, and they were trained in this responsibility. And so I can use this notion of Paideia to ask, you know, what have we why do we not take care of our, or why are we not so concerned or more concerned with our Paideia, and so this is how it works.
Well, that's fantastic. Thank you very much, Ingrid. I mean, unless there's anything else you'd like to add, I think, you know, we might be able to wrap it up. For anyone who wants to dive deeper into some of the things we discussed today, again, Ingrid has written this paper, Bildung from Paideia to the Modern Subject, published on the Oxford Encyclopedia of Education. And so it was a fantastic read about Bildung and Paideia and Danning. And so thank you very much, Ingrid. It's been great to have you.
Thank you so much, Chris. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Okay. Well, that's it for the program today. As mentioned, we are on a summer programming special. So we're doing less programming right now. Hope to pick that up a bit later. But you can follow us on our Facebook page if you want to find out more information about what's coming on. And yes, you can also find out about you know, what's happening with the program on our book website, and Castoriadis and Autonomy book.info with some hyphens between all of the words. And yes, the Facebook group is Castoriadis and Autonomy. So thank you very much for everyone coming on the joining the program today. We'll see you next time.